A submachine gun has the high rate of fire of a machine gun, but it's basically a pistol. It's something small enough and handy enough to be used close quarters and carried by just the one guy.
It's a sort of a spray and pray machine. It's to keep troops that are advancing at bay. It isn't an accurate weapon. It's just a method of producing a large volume of fire in a short period of time.
Your enemy's in front of you. Get him!
These handheld killers were to become a key infantry weapon in the Second World War. The submachine gun worked on the principle that the more lead you loose off, the greater your chance of killing. The German MP40 was both compact and lethal.
It's got quite a limited range, being just a pistol round, but at close range it can be quite devastating. Up to 20 yards, this would probably penetrate two people. Go through one person and through a second person. So it's got quite a penetrative power.
But one submachine gun towers over the rest of the family. One of the earliest models, it combined the rugged menace of the Wild West with the glamour of Hollywood. Tommy gun, take a bow.
That's the Thompson M1A1 submachine gun.
John Hilliker is a sheriff's deputy and former special forces operative. He's also a massive fan of the iconic Thompson.
Given the option, and I have the options as a sheriff's deputy, whether I would carry an M16 or carry this Thompson. And as you can see, I carry the Thompson. That's what rides in my squad car with me. If you're talking about having a close quarters combat situation, I think this is superior to most any firearm on the market now.
The reason for the popularity of the Thompson was simple. It packed extra punch.
Unlike European submachine guns, which tend to fire 9mm rounds, the Thompson fired the very popular American 45 ACP round, which is a great big round. The Tommy gun was firing a round that could knock people over. And when you were being hit potentially by 20, 30 rounds of this stuff, you knew you were being cut to pieces.
Gun designer General John Thompson discovered that a large, slow-moving bullet could do a lot more damage than a round moving much faster.
There were a lot of experiments done by Thompson, the same man who made this, in 1904.
Thompson figured that the only way to get reliable data on body damage would be to test on real flesh. So he got some steers from the local slaughterhouse.
Basically, what they came out with was that to be an effective man stopper, if you like, velocity didn't matter. A big bullet, even if it is going slow, is much more effective than a small bullet going much faster. And so this is, in effect, a very good round of ammunition.
The Thompson fired an awesome 800 rounds per minute. It packed a 50 bullet or 100 bullet magazine.
You therefore have a huge firepower, very effective at upsetting your opposition.
I'll show you how the magazine goes in. Extended thumb off of the magazine, like this. Give it a couple of good taps to make sure it's in place. All right, you gentlemen have placed up some very aggressive lamps over there for me. So rather than letting them attack us, I guess we should go see if we can handle them. In an urban environment, this is a very comfortable gun to either pull to your shoulder or to actually fire from the hip. And once you've done it a few times, you can get very good with it.
The Thompson was a whole new firearm flavor, and owners dig the taste. Law enforcement officers liked the hard-hitting bullets, and gangsters liked its bad boy rep.
The Tommy gun became the sort of thing which we associate with the gangsters of the 1930s. It became something of a status symbol. I mean, not simply good for sorting out your opponent across a bar or in a car in the street outside, but also went with the fedora and the cigar. Status weapon too.
The Thompson submachine gun was the weapon used during the St. Valentine's Day massacre. And for a gangster, it meant it was a relatively small weapon, giving him a high volume of fire. and something you could conceal. It fits inside a violin case.